Welcome to Ivy Church.
Welcome to Ivy Church.
Welcome to Ivy Church.
Welcome to Ivy Church.
Good to see you.
Welcome to Ivy Church.
Good morning and welcome to Online Church today. Happy Sunday! My name's Louise and I'm one of the leaders here at Ivy. And if you're a regular to Ivy, then welcome back. But if you're new and this is your first time checking us out, then a huge welcome to you. But wherever you're watching from, it is great to welcome you as church online today. But if you are new, then why don't you check us out at ivychurch.org? There's everything that you need to know about us on there. And if you've been away or you've missed any of the talks over the past few weeks, then why don't you subscribe to our YouTube page and you can catch up with everything there. But if you're joining us today on our website, then why don't you say hi in the chat? Use it as a space to ask questions, to give encouragements to one another, and to be together as an online community. It's a really safe space for you to share and chat through any key moments for you. But I also love to remind you that the online team are here to pray with you at any point during the service. And if you're watching via the website, then you'll see there's a prayer button. All you need to do is just click on that, and one of the team will be really happy to pray with you. As part of our time together this morning, we're going to be taking communion. So during worship, you might want to gather the things that you need for that. So some bread, some crackers, maybe some toast, and some sort of drink. And later in the service, I'll be guiding us through together as we celebrate Jesus' life. So we are in our series of Psalm 23 for the year of 2023. So why don't we say the psalm together now? The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This has been a really powerful series so far, where we've been able to really delve deep into each verse. And it's a psalm that's familiar to so many, but yet it has such depth, where we see God's goodness and his kindness as he walks through our life with us as our good shepherd. And today Bernard is sharing with us, looking at the second part of verse 4. So this is your opportunity now to get your Bibles ready, to grab a pen, a highlighter, whatever it is that you need as you listen this morning, to underline those verses and to make some notes. But why don't we pray now before we worship together? Lord God, we thank you so much that you are such a great God. And we thank you that whatever we're walking through, that you walk through it with us. We thank you that your plans for us are to give us a hope and a future. That our strength doesn't come from ourselves, but from you working in and through us. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, God, that we get to worship you today and every day. And I pray that we'll never lose wanting to praise your name and sing songs of worship to you, because you are a great God and you deserve our praise. Thank you that your Holy Spirit is with us all the time, close by our sides, guiding us and loving us. And God, I thank you that you are enough. And I pray for us this morning as we listen and we read your word afresh today. I pray that we will know you close and that we'll feel your presence in that space wherever it is today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Though tears may fall, my song will rise, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I lift my eyes to you. Well, there's hope in my heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with glory, Lord of light, I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, my way. You are the shield around me, always you remain. Like courage in the fight, I hear you call my name. Jesus, I am coming, walking on the waves, reaching for your light. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Your name, shout your Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. At your name, the morning breaks in glory. At your name, creation sings your story. At your name, the angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. The Lord of all the earth will shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. There's no one like, there is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing, we will sing. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. Jesus is our God. We will sing. Holy Lord of all the earth will shout your name, shout your name. Filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. Yes, you are Lord of all the earth. You are Lord of all the earth. We'll shout your name, shout your name. Filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord.
In a moment, we're going to take communion together. But before we do that, we're going to give an opportunity for you to give back to God. And we want to say a huge thank you to those of you who give faithfully to Ivy, as when it comes to giving to this church, we get to both honour and join God in what he's doing here to extend his kingdom. But when we give, it's not about making a sacrifice. It's actually part of our worship to him in giving our everything. It's God working in and through us and teaching us about when we sow well, we will reap an incredible harvest. So if you'd like to give, you can follow the link on the screen now. You can give at any time during the service or through the week. So we're going to take communion together now. And we take communion to remember what Jesus did for us when he died on the cross for us, to forgive us of all our sins. But then on the third day, he rose again just like he said he would. So let's first take a moment to bring anything to God that we need to give to him today. Communion is an opportunity for us to look back at what Christ did for us on the cross by dying for us and then being raised to life again. For us to look around at what we have and who we have that life with, and to look forward to the day when we will share in one big communion celebration in heaven. I'm going to read from the book of Mark. And it says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" So the body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Lord, I come before you today with thanks. In taking communion, we are so thankful to you for your perfect love and the sacrifice you made. Your desire to have a relationship with us was so great that you made a way for us to be with you. We thank you for your love for us, which surpasses all understanding. Thank you for enduring the pain and humiliation of the cross in our place and declaring us righteous before the Father. Like, we don't deserve your grace, but you have extended it to us freely, and we thank you. Amen. We're going to hear from Bernard now.
Hi, I'm continuing with the series of our Year of Blessing, looking at the beautiful Psalm 23. It has been a well-used source of encouragement to those at funerals or as a song of worship in church services. So let's read the Psalm 23 together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'm going to share with you the link today between David's inspirational words with the ministry of the Lord Jesus. Today we're looking at the last sentence of verse 4. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The title of my sermon today is Our Confidence and Reassurance is in the Good Shepherd. David wrote this psalm for comfort, not only for himself, having faced many troubled times, but also to help comfort and inspire anyone who reads it and puts it into action. What does the dictionary say what comfort means? It is the state of physical ease and freedom from pain or constraint. The easing or alleviation of a person's feelings of grief or distress. To give strength and hope. The key to David's inspiration in writing this psalm was his personal experience and belief that it was the presence of his great shepherd in his life at that time, and to point our focus forward 1,000 years to Jesus' ministry, in particular the proclamation that he makes in John 10:11, where he says, he is the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. It is the presence of the Lord, the good shepherd, that makes all the difference in our lives. The first aspect of our confidence and reassurance in the Good Shepherd is in his presence. So let's look at the Good Shepherd's presence. When David says, for thou art with me, he knew his comfort was in the presence of the Lord. Even when he went through the crucible of difficulties, danger, and life-threatening situations, he knew and had confidence in the presence of the Lord, who was his shepherd. In this world, we live with so much anxiety and worry and fear. Yet, we must remember, like David, God is with us through it all. Our tendency is like the disciples in the boat at the height of the storm, is to look at the wind and the waves around us, to focus on our problems, our struggles. Yet, when we look up to Jesus, he is there with his arm outstretched to us. Yes, Jesus provides the confidence and the reassurance in our Christian journey. An example of this is in Matthew 28, verse 20, where we have Jesus in the commissioning of the disciples saying, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Do you remember, as a child growing up, learning to ride a bike for the first time, where mum or dad is walking along, running along, holding on to your seat, whilst you are struggling to keep your balance, and the only thing that is giving you the confidence and the reassurance of success is the caring presence of the parent's hand urging you on. What a picture. We today, like David, can know and experience the reassuring presence of the hand of the Lord. He will lovingly provide for, guide, and heal, and protect every person who puts their faith and trust in him. I remember attending an International Christian Chamber of Commerce gathering in Guildford. And at the end, in a plenary session, we were organized into various groups of 12, 14 for prayer ministry. And a few minutes into the session, I heard the Lord say to me that the man and woman opposite needed to hear that the Lord knows their concerns about their daughter at home. After plucking up the courage, I told them the message. It was clear by their reaction that they were astonished by the message, and immediately they broke into tears and began to openly share about their daughter's personal crisis. I then shared that Jesus was also saying he was with them and not to worry. I received a letter a couple of weeks later saying that the Lord's presence was tangible and the crisis had been lovingly resolved. It was the reassuring presence of Jesus the Good Shepherd that made all the difference to that couple's life. Another aspect of the reassuring presence of the Good Shepherd is in the reference change in Psalm 23, verse 4. From talking about the Lord as he in previous verses to the more personal you, which I believe infers a more intimate, closer relationship experience of David and his shepherd. Jesus confirms this to us in John 10, 14, where he says, I am the Good Shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. I read an article from someone a little while ago saying that we are more prone to talk about the Lord when we are in the green pastures, and more prone to talk to the Lord when we're in the dangerous valley. Yes, in the light, we are prone to wander off in pursuit of greener grass, but in the dark, we have a tendency to hug his knee and keep on holding while we're going through difficulties. In his book entitled Have Faith Without Fear, Kenneth L. Wilson says, isn't that what we really want most in our valleys? The assurance that someone is there. There is no valley, no matter how dark, that you will go through alone. He, the Good Shepherd, will not leave you. This is confirmed in Hebrews chapter 13, where it says, I will never leave you or forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? David, from his experience of being a shepherd, also saw his continuing comfort in the presence of the shepherd's rod and staff, both providing God's pastoral care over him. So David saw that the presence of the rod and the staff as a comfort. I believe these symbolically can be likened to the word of truth and spirit. Jesus' gospel is the rod of strength and of power, which provides comfort for Christians. The staff being the daily guidance through the promised Comforter, the Holy Spirit. So this brings us now to the next aspect of our confidence and reassurance in Jesus the Good Shepherd. So the Good Shepherd's power is the next aspect of this. The word rod from the Psalm 23 is shebet in Hebrew and means four things. Firstly, a scepter, a branch, a stick for defense, and authority. In David's day, there was comfort and consolation in seeing the rod in the shepherd's skillful hands. In Philip Keller's book entitled The Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23, he raises the importance of the rod as God's word and says that in our day there is great assurance in our hearts as we contemplate the power, the veracity, and the potent authority vested in God's word. In his proclamation as the Good Shepherd, Jesus is the authoritative word to exercise the miracles needed to care for those in his care and those that are lost and in need to be found. A particular example of this is when Jesus is in John 11, he is called to visit his friends Mary and Martha in their loss of their brother and his friend Lazarus. He exercises his authority in the words, "Lazarus, come forth," to raise Lazarus from the dead. Even today, it is Jesus, the living word, that provides the pastoral care of those who follow him. This includes the discipline we need from Scripture to help us, to keep us on the right track. The care and the protection we need when in danger or in need. He also encourages us to use his authority in our needs. It says in Luke chapter 10, verse 19, "Listen carefully. I have given you authority that you now possess to tread on serpents and scorpions and the ability to exercise authority over all the power of the enemy, and nothing in any way will harm you." That is from the Amplified Version. The experience of a friend and a business colleague called Ernest Willie is an example of Jesus' authoritative care. He was a born-again Christian, filled with the Holy Spirit. He contracted cancer of the throat and mouth, and after some time in treatment, he was told by the consultants in the Kent and Canterbury Hospital that there was nothing further that they could do. They advised him to go home and to be with his family in his final moments. By this time, he had many people praying for him, including people who were mightily used by God in healing ministry, like Ian Andrews. He went home, and whilst waiting for what seemed the inevitable, even though he couldn't speak, he was moved to pray in his mind, "I take authority over this in Jesus' name." Morning came and went. Then a day went by. Then he realized that something was happening. Within a few days, the deformity in his mouth and throat began to disappear. What seemed certain death changed to life. He went back to the consultants in the hospital, who were astonished and said, "Ernest, go and write a book about it. It is a miracle." Some of us are listening today, might be facing a difficulty in your lives, and you have come to a point where you don't know which way to turn, and you are wondering what you can do. I would like to encourage you to move in the authority of Jesus, the Good Shepherd, and begin to take authority that he has given you in his name. The next aspect of our confidence and reassurance in Jesus, the Good Shepherd, is in the Good Shepherd's purpose. The shepherd's staff, as you may have gathered, is a long stick with a curve or a crook or a hook on the end. As I mentioned earlier, the staff is symbolic of the Spirit of God. And Philip Keller, in his book, describes the staff as Christ's dealings with us as individuals. There's the essence of the sweetness, the comfort, and the consolation, the gentle correction brought about by the work of his gracious Spirit. Jesus said in John 14, "But the Comforter, even the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said unto you." The Hebrew word for staff is misgeder, meaning what a person leans on for support. Like the shepherd David, Jesus the Good Shepherd is the support provided through the Holy Spirit. As with David, the shepherd, Christ Jesus uses the staff to guide, to unite, and to direct the sheep. So the Holy Spirit will give us purpose and direction in our walk with our Christian journey. There are many examples of this, but one that comes to mind is in Luke 24, verses 30 to 32, regarding the disciples on the road to Emmaus, where it says, "When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?'" It was Jesus' physical presence and through the Holy Spirit that set them on their journey with renewed hope for the future. Again, Jesus says to us in John 16, 13, "But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth." I remember in my first year of being a Christian and having my own business consultancy, I joined the Gideons to help share the Bibles out in hotels or at schools, which I enjoyed. However, 6 months into it, one night in a prayer time in the Gideons business meeting, I had heard the audible voice saying to me, "Resign from the Gideons." It came as a bit of a shock because I'd only got started in the ministry and the work. It was a clear message by the Holy Spirit. So in my obedience, even though I didn't understand why, I resigned with immediate effect. Within a week, I was asked by my pastor at that time to share the ministry with him in the church. Then as you may have been gathering, leaving the Gideons was the Lord directing my paths. It was his decision, not mine. This is just like the Good Shepherd with us, with his staff, indulging me in the right direction. I felt the warmth of being in the care of Christ, my Good Shepherd. So how should we respond to Jesus, the Good Shepherd? Even though David composed this wonderful Psalm 23 and knew the comfort of his presence of the Lord, his shepherd, he didn't stop him experiencing everyday problems. Jesus doesn't take us out of the broken world when we become Christ's followers, but he is with us in the world. Will you take his hand today? Will you receive his grace and peace in your life? Whatever you're facing this week, just know that Jesus is greater. He still calms the storms and redeems lives. God is with you and he is for you. The name of God Jehovah over our passage today is called Jehovah Shammah, meaning the Lord is there. Will you live in the confidence of his truth today? How do we respond to this message today? By having a faith focusing firstly on the Good Shepherd's presence, being with you because he promised that he will never leave you or forsake you, actively drawing near to him. It says in James 4:8, come close to God with a contrite heart, and he will come close to you. Secondly, having a faith focused on the power and the authority in your life by declaring his name over your life situations and needs. And thirdly, having a faith focused on the purpose and direction and plan for your life by asking Jesus into your decisions every day and ministry and acknowledging his voice and direction in your life. I don't know whether you've noticed or not, but whenever you saw Jesus working away in his ministry here on earth, the three things that stand mostly in my mind is firstly, he is present. Secondly, he is using his power. And thirdly, he gives people purpose in their life. I want you to experience that today, and I want you to allow him to come right now in his presence, in his power, and for his purposes in your life. Allow him to move in your life this morning or in this day. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for these wonderful truths, the presence, the power, and the purpose of Jesus Christ in our lives makes it so much better. David knew it way back 1,000 years before. But even now, today, 2,000 years on since Christ was here on earth, we can experience these things today. So help us, Lord, we pray, to feel that sense of your presence, your power, and your purpose in our lives. If you feel that you want to offer Jesus these things and you want to act these things in your life, then I invite you to pray and to seek him in this day, and he will respond in your circumstance, and he will show you that he is very able to meet your need today. Thank you.
Thank you, Bernard, for such a brilliant word. Thank you for encouraging us, just as David did, to experience the presence, the power, and the purpose of Jesus as the Good Shepherd. It was so, so good. Thank you. There'll be some questions now that come up on the screen, and we want to give you an opportunity to reflect on what it is that you've heard today. And if you're on your own at the moment, then why don't you write your answers and questions in the chat and then share on there. But if you're with others in the room, maybe you could pause the chat now and discuss your thoughts together. Thank you.
is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
I wonder what it is that you need to do as a result of what you'd heard from Bernard today. But I really pray that you'll know the presence of God is in your life with you this week, whatever it is that your week looks like. We'd love to invite you to any of our services next week. We have in-person services at Didsbury and at Cheadlehume, as well as our online service here at 10:30, and you are super welcome to any of those that you choose. Don't forget to keep checking the website or our social media pages for everything that's going on across Ivy. We have so many things that are happening, so look out for information about our summer plans and other things that we have. Thank you so much for being with me this morning. I have loved being with you all today. Have a blessed day and a blessed week, and we'll see you soon. Thank you.